Yo, what's up guys, Alf here, and today I'm going to be starting a brand new series on the channel. So this is a series that I'm calling Brews from Scratch, and essentially the idea behind this series is I've had feedback from a few people saying that they'd be quite interested in watching the deck building process rather than just the final results of the deck. And so I've got a bunch of different ideas that I haven't got around to trying yet, and I thought it could be interesting to record myself building the deck from the very beginning and talking you through my deck building decisions as I'm doing them. So talking about why I prefer certain cards over others, what I think could be added to the deck, potential directions you could take it, why I'm running some cards over others, for example, and then obviously we'll play some games with it, see how the deck plays out, see potential strengths and weaknesses, see potential changes that we might want to make to the deck, and just see where it goes from there. So anyway, we're going to start off with this combo that I've been quite excited to brew around and haven't got around to yet. But basically, with the Brothers War release, we got Yotian Dissident and Ashnod's Altar, which essentially give you infinite +1/+1 counters and infinite 1/1 tokens if you pair it with animation modules. So kind of similar to how the Scurry Oak combo works, which is already a deck that exists in Historic. So I'm going to quickly explain how the combo works. Yotian Dissident puts +1/+1 counters on target creature whenever an artifact enters the battlefield under our control. So if we have Yotian Dissident in play and we have animation module in play, animation module says whenever one or more +1/+1 counters are put on a permanent you control, you may pay one. If you do, you create a 1/1 artifact creature token. So if you have Yotian Dissident in play and you play animation module, that will trigger the Yotian Dissident, putting a +1/+1 counter on itself. Then you can pay one mana to put a 1/1 into play, which will then trigger the Yotian Dissident again, puts a +1/+1 counter on it, then you can pay one. So the only limit here is how much mana you have available. So when we add Ashnod's Altar into the mix, we can basically produce two mana by sacrificing one of the 1/1s we make, which then enables us to do animation module twice, essentially. So if we have these three cards together, we have infinite +1/+1 counters off the Yotian Dissident and infinite 1/1 tokens off the animation module, which, as we've seen from Scurry Oak, is a pretty powerful way to win the game. Now, the reason why I'm particularly excited about this combo is because, generally, like, a heuristic that's almost always held true for me when building combo decks is if you have a lot of redundancy for your combo, by which I mean a lot of different ways that you can combo off, you know, you have multiple ways to set up your combo. I think a good example of this is Paradox Engine, where you can go off with Emery, you can go off with Karn, you can go off with Kinnan or Reality Chip. Those sorts of decks where you have lots of different ways of comboing off, you can kind of afford to build the whole deck around it. Whereas if you have a combo like this, where you don't have much redundancy because you need very specific pieces, then I think it's almost always better to be running that deck in a plan, so alongside a plan B, essentially, because the issue if you try to build this deck all around the combo is the disparity in your hand quality is going to be really big. Some hands you'll just have the combo, some hands you'll have, you know, one or two combo pieces and then other cards to find your combo, and those other hands where you just have loads of ways to dig for your combo are just significantly slower than the hands where you just have it straight away. So it means that you're more likely to mulligan, which makes you more vulnerable to discard spells and counter spells. On top of that, Sideboard hate is also going to be even better against you if your deck is more one-dimensional around the combo. So if you have a combo that fits nicely into a plan B shell, that's really appealing. And this particular combo, I think, suits very well with the Hardened Scales shell. So Hardened Scales is a deck that I've tried building in Historic multiple times, and it's always felt really close to being good, but not quite good enough. And so I'm thinking you could potentially build a Hardened Scales deck with all three of these cards, because they all work fairly well with Hardened Scales. Obviously, Yotian Dissident gives +1/+1 counters on stuff when you have artifacts entering the battlefield, and I think from my experience building this deck in Historic, that Hardened Scales decks are generally better quality with artifacts, because you have the modular cards like Zabaz and the Arcbound cards. You have stuff like Hangerback Walker as well, so you can definitely build an artifact-based Hardened Scales deck, and Yotian Dissident is perfect there. Animation Module is already a card that sees play in Hardened Scales decks, and Ashnod's Altar, you know, while it doesn't fit as cleanly into the archetype as the other two, can still have a lot of use, because a lot of the times in Hardened Scales decks, you want to be able to move your +1/+1 counters around your creatures, which is one of the main reasons why Zabaz was so good, because Zabaz allows you to sacrifice your creatures to move your +1/+1 counters around. And Ashnod's Altar does a similar thing whilst also generating mana, which is good with other cards like Hangerback Walker as well. So I think all these three cards can be reasonable in a Hardened Scales shell. Now, there's two main ways I've thought of building this deck. One is basically a Hardened Scales deck with this combo inside it, and the other one is more of a focused a bit more on the combo, using Kaya's Resurrection, I think is the name of the card. Let me just check it. Or maybe it's Kyla. Hold on, let me just check. Yeah, here we go. Oh, Kyla's Reconstruction. So this is essentially like a collected company for creatures and artifacts. And I think this could potentially work very well with Ashnod's Altar. If you have a bunch of cheap creatures that you can sacrifice to the altar, and then you can pump all of your mana into Kyla's Reconstruction, this hits all of your combo pieces. So this is another way that I'm tempted to build a deck, but I'm not 100% sure on that. That seems a little bit less reliable than just Hardened Scales with this in it. So today, I'm just going to focus on Hardened Scales with the combo in, and then maybe in a future episode, if people are interested, I could try building this more all-in version with Kyla's Reconstruction. But anyway, with the running this inside a Hardened Scales deck, the very first thing that's a little bit hard to figure out is the numbers of these cards. I think Yotian Dissident you can run as a 4 or fairly easily because it's just really, really good in the Hardened Scales shell. Ashnod's Altar and Animation Module aren't cards that you really want to be running in very high numbers because it's just going to lead to clunky draws. You know, Animation Module, I could see maybe as a 2 or 3 of. Ashnod's Altar, I really don't want to be running more than 2 of because it's a card you really don't want to be drawing multiples of. So that's one slightly annoying thing that you are going to have to run slightly fewer numbers of your combo pieces, but you're going to end up with super clunky hands if you run 4 of each. One card that does help out with this, though, is Ingenious Smith. So this is a card that I think is going to be really good in the deck because it basically finds all of our combo pieces. Almost all of the rest of the deck is going to be artifacts as well, so it's great to find whatever you need to dig for. And it also puts +1/+1 counters on itself naturally, which is good with Hardened Scales as well. So I think Ingenious Smith is really good. One thing to note already is that we're playing an artifact-based deck, and we already have 12 non-artifacts in the deck. So I'm going to make a concerted effort from this point onwards to only add artifacts to the deck unless they're incredibly important. Because if you add too many non-artifacts, you're just going to end up with hands where you have like multiple Hardened Scales and Yotian Dissidents and not enough artifacts to trigger them. Or your Ingenious Smith will start bricking because you don't have enough artifacts in the deck. So from now on, I think because we have so many non-artifacts, I'm going to add more artifacts to the deck in general. One card that I'm definitely going to add to the deck is Esper Sentinel. So this is one of the best cards in the format in general. It's an artifact, so it plays well with the, you know, artifact synergies that we've got going on. And we can also boost its power as well. You know, we can put counters on it with Yotian Dissident. I'm going to add Ozolith to the deck as well, which allows us to move counters around. We're probably going to be running some modular creatures, so this is probably going to be one of the better Esper Sentinel decks because it synergizes with what we're doing and we can boost its power as well. Other one-offs, I think we probably want one-off Shadowspear as well. Now, Shadowspear and Ozolith are both cards that I could see running multiple copies of. I definitely think the opportunity cost of running the first copy is relatively low. I think Ozolith has always been very, very good when I've run it in Hardened Scales, and I could potentially see running more copies because of Ashnod's Altar, because Ashnod's Altar allowing you to sacrifice creatures. Then you put the +1/+1 counters on the Ozolith, and then you can move the counters with the Ozolith to like a flyer or a creature that has a Shadow Spear attached or something like that, just to give you ways to force damage through seems quite powerful. So if we're playing and I notice that Ashnod's Altar seems a little bit underpowered, I might consider running more Ozoliths because these seem to work quite well together, I think. We definitely want to consider the modular cards as well. I think the modular cards are going to fit perfectly into this deck. Zabaz is definitely the best one. I'm going to start off with 3 because I think we're probably going to struggle to fit everything in the deck if we're running 4. And it is legendary as well, so there is a drawback to that. But Zabaz is very, very good in the deck, especially if we're running Arcbound Mouser, which is another card I'm very high on from previous testing with Hardened Scales. I think Lifelink is huge at just enabling you to stabilize against the aggro decks, giving you ways to put games out of reach without needing Shadow Spear. And, you know, say you have Hardened Scales, it's going to be a 1-mana 2-2 lifelinker, and then we can start putting counters on it with the Yotian Dissident or moving them around with Ozolith. And then when it dies, we can obviously put the modular counters on another creature like Esper Sentinel. So I really like these. I'm going to start off with a 3 and 4 split. Arcbound Prototype is a card that I've run in the past, but I just don't think it's that good. I mean, I'll put one in the deck just so we don't forget about it, but I'd be pretty surprised if this ends up making the cut in the end. Another card that I definitely think I want to run 4 copies of is Hangerback Walker. This is a card that obviously... Oh, I can't spell. Sorry, I'm having to type with one hand because I'm holding my mic with the other. But yeah, Hangerback Walker is a card that I think is just generically good in Hardened Scales anyway, but I think is even better in this particular build because of Ashnod's Altar. Being able to sacrifice Hangerback Walker to produce a bunch of flyers or just sacrifice other stuff to produce mana to then used to pay for Hangerback Walker seems really, really powerful. So I think I'm definitely high on running this as a 4 of. And then we definitely want some removal in the main deck because, you know, I don't think you can reasonably survive in best of three without removal right now because of decks like, is it Wizards that are trying to race you? You know, the Thopter's decks are still about. And so I think Portable Hold is the best choice for interaction because not only does it deal with early creatures, but it also deals with non-creature spells like Retrofitter Foundry, opposing Portable Holds, and we can fetch it off the Ingenious Smith as well, which is pretty nice. So we're already at 62 cards. I think we can definitely get away with 22 lands in this deck for sure because we've got a relatively low curve. Now, one thing to note about this particular build of the deck is, as you can see from the curve of the deck, almost all of my previous testing with Hardened Scales decks has been with Lurrus. Running Ashnod's Altar does mean that we lose Lurrus, but it does also mean that we gain the benefit of running, being able to run stuff like Guardian of Faith. So I've been thinking about this deck before I started building this, and obviously one of the big weaknesses of this deck in general is it's an artifact deck, so you're going to be very weak to Divine Purge, you're going to be very weak to Brotherhood's End and Shatterstorm and stuff like that. And not running Lurrus enables you to run Guardian of Faith, which isn't like a completely clean answer, but I think it will definitely help post-sideboard against control, just saving your entire board from Divine Purge, from Brotherhood's End, anything like that. Guardian of Faith seems really good at protecting your board, and I don't think you've really got much of a better option. You know, Mana Tithe was always really lackluster at stopping stuff like Divine Purge in the Thopter's deck, and outside of that you got Teferi's Protection. I think Guardian of Faith is just better than Teferi's Protection. Even though Teferi's Protection protects your non-creature spells, being able to just flash in Guardian of Faith as a threat against control, you know, maybe to attack down a Teferi or a Wandering Emperor, for example, means that I definitely prefer this over something like Teferi's Protection. Another thing that, like, even though this is double pip, I definitely think we want to be running Gigantha as well. You know, with Ashnod's Altar especially, you want to have ways to utilize your mana even when you don't have much in hand, and Gigantha will really help out with that. So I'm going to run Gigantha as the companion for sure. Oh, can't spell. And then, yeah, we're already down to, you know, one card remaining in the deck because I really don't like the Arcbound prototype. I don't think that's going to make the cut, really. So, oh, wait, we can't run... Okay, yeah, we can't run Gigantha with Hangerback Walker. Okay, that's unfortunate, but it is what it is. Now, honestly, looking at this deck, I mean, you are just giving up Lurrus to run the combo, so we'll have to see what that payoff's like, really. Because just looking at this deck, I could very easily see just cutting the Ashnod's Altar, running more regular Hardened Scale stuff, and running Lurrus, but then you do lose out on Guardian of Faith, which does seem like probably a better answer to stuff like Divine Purge and Brotherhood's End that you have access to in white and green. So we still have another space left in the main deck. So I think I'm going to quickly just search for artifact cards that have +1/+1 counter synergies in case I've missed anything. And also to explain, you know, go over certain cards that I'm not particularly high on that other people might be. So there's nothing on this page. Okay, so Lion Sash is a card that does synergize quite well in Hardened Scales. But as Graveyard Hate, this is just way too slow. I don't think Scavenging Ooze or that style of effect has been good in Historic for a very long time. I think if you're running Graveyard Hate, you have to be running more efficient stuff like Unlicensed Curse or Tormod's Crypt. So Lion Sash, not a card I'm super high on. Or what's it? Okay, Autonomous Assembler. So this is interesting. I've not considered this card yet. So 5 mana, 4/5, and then you can prototype it. So, I mean, I'm not really high on this card either, to be honest, just reading it through again. It basically is very reminiscent of Steel Overseer, which is a card that I think is much better than the Assembler, and I'm probably not going to run the Steel Overseer anyway, so I don't think that one's quite good enough, unfortunately. Skip through all these. Any green ones? Oh, what's this? When's the battlefield? Okay, that's interesting. I'll put that in the deck just to consider it. I don't think we want the Verdurous Gearhulk. That's just way too expensive. Okay, Clay Champion is a card that I've considered in other decks. I was trying this in the sideboard of Elves that I was running with Karn. And, you know, this seems fine in Hardened Scales, but I just think it's too expensive, to be honest. You know, if you're having to get, you know, to 4 mana just to cast a generic creature that doesn't even pass on its +1/+1 counters when it dies. Obviously, if you have Hardened Scales in play, this is going to be huge. If you go like white, white, green, green, you get a lot of different counters. But I think in general, this is probably going to be too slow. Although having said that, it does pair pretty nicely with the Ashnod's Altar. Oh, no, it doesn't, because you need to pay... you need to pay coloured mana. For a second, I thought you'd just be able to pump a bunch of Ashnod's altar mana into it, but that doesn't work, unfortunately. So not super high on that, to be honest. Animation module is honestly a card I could see going up to three. You know, typically I don't really want to go more than one or two, but when it's paired with Ashnod's altar, that does provide a decent mana sink. So going up to third animation module is definitely something I'm considering. Shadow Spirit is also a card that I'm tempted to put in the sideboard. Oop. Just as a one-off, so that in matchups where the lifelink is very relevant, you might want an additional one. Although we do already have Arcbound Mouser, so I'll keep it in there for now. And if we run out of space, I might end up cutting that. Just want to make sure we're not missing out on any other cards that I haven't thought of. Okay, yeah, Patchwork Automaton. So this is a card that is very good in hardened scales as well. But honestly, I'm not really sure what we cut to make room for it. And we do, you know, this has felt at its best when I've built hardened scales decks with stuff like Reality Chip or Wickerwing Effigy, where you're playing artifacts off the top of your library. When you're doing that sort of thing, Automaton is really strong, but I'm not really sure it's better than anything else we've got going on here. Like, Yotian Dissident is going to spread out the counters more and is part of our combo as well. So I think Patchwork Automaton, you know, if we were struggling for playables, would be one that I would put in, but I'm not sure it's better than any of the other cards. You know, Mouser having lifelink is huge. Zabaz in general is just really good at, you know, bouncing your counters around. Giving it flying to be able to attack in the air for a bunch of damage is really huge as well. Whereas I think the problem with Automaton is it just doesn't do well against chump blockers. The opponent can just chump block this all day. If I was running a build with more ways to play off the top of the library, then I'd definitely consider it. Steel Overseer is another card that I've played a bunch in hardened scales in the past, but I think especially right now in the metagame where there's tons of single target removal because of the presence of Izzet Wizards, and now the Goblin Trapfinder decks as well, where you need to be able to Fatal Push the Ominous Traveler, I don't think, you know, the chances of Steel Overseer living are pretty low. And we're also running a fairly high number of non-artifact creatures in Ingenious Smith and Yotian Dissident, so I imagine that you'll end up with board states where you have Overseer and Ingenious Smith, and it's not really doing that much work there. So I don't think Overseer really makes the cut, unfortunately. And then just checking others. I mean, obviously Nettle Assist is powerful in an artifact deck, but we're much more of a +1/+1 counter synergy deck. And Stonecall Serpent's an interesting one. I used to play this in the past as well, and it was very good against stuff like Izzet Phoenix, for example, back in the day. But again, I'm not really sure it makes the cut anymore. I think Hangerback Walker, especially when we're combining it with Ashnod's Altar, is generally better. So overall, I didn't really see anything there that massively excited me. I mean, the Simulacrum is interesting, but again, I think it's probably a little bit too expensive. So I think what I'm going to do just to start off with here is I'm going to go three animation module just to try and maximize our chances of seeing the combo a little bit more. And I could very well see this becoming a second Ozolith, a second Shadow Spear, maybe even a third Ashnod's Altar, although I'm not really convinced about that, to be honest. So then sideboard-wise, obviously we've got the Guardian of Faiths in here, which I think are, you know, they're not perfect, but they are at least a solution to the mass artifact removal, which is going to be quite important, I think. Also, having Yotian Dissident and Ingenious Smith is going to be helpful against Brotherhood's End as well, which is, you know, not nothing. We definitely want more interaction for decks like Izzet Wizards, so I think we probably just want to run for Glass Casket in the sideboard, because that's something that will trigger our Yotian Dissident, something that we can find off the Ingenious Smith as well. So I always like Casket in Ingenious Smith decks as extra removal. Then other decks, I mean, the Trapfinder deck is definitely a concern. I really like being able to run Hushbringer. If this deck can run Hushbringer in the sideboard, that would be a huge boon, because that will really help against Goblins and against the Trapfinder deck as well. Now, it does shut off the Ingenious Smith. I just need to check the wording on this to see if it shuts off the Yotian Dissident. As creatures entering the battlefield or dying don't cause abilities to trigger. So yeah, unfortunately, that does look like it stops the combo, because if if a 1-1 token enters off animation module, that's not going to trigger the Yotian Dissident. So we can't run Hushbringer, which is pretty annoying. You know, I've felt like Hushbringer is very, very well positioned in the historic metagame right now. Another solution, though, to help against the Trapfinder deck specifically could be Karn the Great Creator, because if the Trapfinder decks or the Traveler decks are all relying on Ashnod's Altar instead of Burgi, Karn the Great Creator is a pretty effective way of shutting that down, because they're also a very creature light deck, which means they're unlikely to be able to attack down the Karn unless they're running, you know, I guess Flesh Gorger can attack it down pretty efficiently, but you're generally going to be able to commit to the board a lot faster than the opponent. So I think Karn could be good, and that then it also doubles up as a good card against the Affinity and Thopters decks as well. Now, it's going to be slightly harder to defend because they commit to the board faster than the Trapfinder decks, but I think this could be a good answer. And you could also sideboard in such a way that Karn can actually grab you decent stuff as well. You know, you could, for example, just side out one Hangerback Walker, one Portable Hole, and then Karn can grab you like a proactive play and removal as well. Another card that I think I also want to be running here is Pithing Needle. Now, that's obviously going to be good at shutting off decks like Goblin Charbelcher, but I feel like it's probably going to be an important card to shut off Goblin Trashmaster against the Goblins decks, because that's going to be one of the best cards against you, unfortunately. And then we also definitely want some Graveyard Hate as well. Unlicensed Hearse is always going to be my pick for just generically good Graveyard Hate, and it doubles up as a threat as well, which is nice. So we've already got a pretty decent sideboard. What I always do before finalizing the numbers is just see how I would sideboard in each matchup to see if the number of cards I've got in the sideboard match up with the number of cards I want to cut in each matchup. So, for example, against aggro decks like Is It Wizards, honestly, we might be interested in just trimming the combo because these are kind of slow value generating cards, and I think your backup plan of just get big creatures with +1/+1 counters on it are going to be able to beat the opponent's aggro game plan. So we obviously want the four glass caskets in that matchup. I'll just put them all together so it's a bit easier to read. Right, so we definitely want the glass caskets and the shadow spear, and that's already five cards, swapping in for five, so that's perfect for the aggro matchups. Just swap out Ashnod's Altar and the animation module for shadow spear for casket control. We want the Guardian of Faiths and we don't want the portable holes. Is there anything else that we don't really want in control? I mean, Shadow Spear's probably not that great, but it has put in work against Wandering Emperor tokens when I've been playing the Thopters deck, so maybe that's a straight swap there. Guardian of Faith for Portable Hole. I'm not really sure. You know, obviously, Planeswalkers are good against control, but we don't really have any good targets to fetch with it, which would be the main reason. So I think Karn is probably a card that's relegated just for the Trapfinder, I guess Charbelcher as well, and Artifact decks as well. Against Goblins, we probably want some caskets and Pithing Needle, and maybe we don't want to cut the combo against Goblins because that is a way that we can generally go bigger than them. What would we want to cut? I mean, Esper Sentinel's probably not that great, so we can just swap four of them out for Pithing Needle and three casket, and then, you know, maybe cut an animation module for the last casket. So generally, I mean, this is just a rough first draft, but before I start playing, I always just try and think, okay, how many cards do I want to cut in each matchup? How many cards do I want to bring in? And it seems like we've got a pretty decent mix overall. Mana base-wise, like I said, I think we're pretty happy with 22 lands in general. I don't really like going lower than 22, even in a deck that has a very low curve here, because, you know, being stuck on two lands is kind of rough. It is a bit annoying that we're not running a companion, though. You know, one of the main reasons that you could get away with running 22 in a deck like Thopters was because you always had access to Lurrus in case you did flood out, but I mean, you have a lot of mana sinks in the deck. You know, Ingenious Smith is going to find you stuff. Animation Module's a mana sink. Hangerback Walker's a mana sink. Zabaz is kind of a mana sink as well. So, I mean, I'm going to start off with 22. Unless the deck is super, super aggressive and doesn't have many mana sinks, I don't really like going lower than that because the chances of you missing land drops are quite high. Now, we definitely do need to run enough colored sources. We definitely need white on turn one, and we also kind of need green on turn one for our fastest start. So we need to try and run 14 of each according to the Frank Carsten article. So I'll start off by having a look at the green white jewel lands we have available. I'm basically looking for any green white jewels that will enter untapped in the first few turns. So Pathway for sure. Brushland's actually a sick new addition from Brothers War for this archetype, actually. Definitely want Temple Garden as well. So we're already at 12. We only need two more of each to meet the, you know, the amounts that Frank Carsten says you need to consistently have it on turn one, which is nice. We can run Iganjo and Biseiju as one ofs, which is decent. Now, you could consider running a third color, but there's nothing that's really, you know, come out to me as really important, because the only time I've ever really splashed a third color in Hardened Scales decks is when I was running blue for counter spells. Obviously, Divine Purge is just the best card against you because you're an artifact deck. So in the Lurrus build of the deck, I was having to splash blue for counter spells in the sideboard like Metallic Rebuke, and I was also running low numbers of Reality Chip in the main deck. But now, since we're not running Luris because we're running Ashnod's Altar, I think Guardian of Faith is, you know, a decent enough answer to stuff like Divine Purge, or, you know, it's as good as you're going to get in white and green. And splashing a third color definitely does come with its constraints in the mana base as well. So we're already at 14 of each. We definitely want some basics. So we'll run one of each basic. And then, because we've got Ingenious Smith, I think we can afford to run a couple of artifact lands. I think Darksteel Citadel is probably the best, so that you don't get completely blown out by Brotherhood's End. Now, I don't want to go too heavy on this because it does make you weaker to Divine Purge, and we don't have Thought Monitor or Nettle Cyst to really take that much advantage of the extra artifacts. The only reason that we're really running this is because we can get it off Ingenious Smith, and it also triggers the Yotian Dissident, which is nice as well. But I don't really want to go higher than two because it just makes you super vulnerable to, like, March of Otherworldly Light and Divine Purge. You know, the fact that your opponent can March of Otherworldly Light your lands for one mana is kind of brutal. So there's a chance that these aren't even important enough that they might end up being cut. You know, giving control the opportunity to essentially stone rain your lands for one mana might not be worth the upside of just occasionally fetching a land off Ingenious Smith. But I'm going to start off with two, and then we've still got four lands to pad the deck out. Now, we could consider running some creature lands like Lair of the Hydra, which could be nice with Ashnod's Altar if we have a lot of excess mana, but I think we're primarily a white deck. Yeah, we're much more heavily white than green, so I don't think we really want to be running any more green lands, really, unless I think I might just run three extra planes and one of the white-green slow lands. Now, the slow land, obviously, in a curve like this isn't great, but it's just reasonable mana fixing. I don't think I really want to go higher than one. You know, you could maybe go to two as a push, but I think this is fine overall. I mean, the white-green artifact land is the only other consideration, really, but if you look at the curve of the deck, we're so low curve that I really don't think you want tap lands in the early game at all, really. So I think I quite like the mana base as it is. You know, it's not very flashy, but I don't think you really need it to be. You just want your colors on curve for this deck to work out. So I think this is a pretty reasonable first draft of the deck. If there's any cards you think I might have forgotten, because I have gone through this quite quickly, I have brainstormed a few ideas beforehand, but I'm sure there's some potential good options that I might have missed, so definitely let me know if there's any in the comments. Okay, sweet, so we've got the initial build of the deck down here. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to fire this deck through a constructed event, a historic constructed event. I would normally play on ladder, but it's right near the end of the season, and I'm hopefully going to try and push for rank 1 at the end if I can. I only got 3 hours left after I've recorded this, so I don't want to tank my rank trying out a completely new deck if it doesn't end up working out. So I'm going to fire it through a historic constructed event. I'll probably highlight the match from that event that is the most interesting to watch. And then after that, I'm going to go back, maybe rebuild the deck, maybe make some changes that I think would improve the deck, and then run it back through a constructed event again with the changes and show you one of the matches from that event as well. So you get to see gameplay, you know, before and after. So we'll see how it goes. I'll see you in the constructed event match. Okay, so this is our first match in an event, so hopefully we'll get, you know, more tier 1 decks, or at least, like, you know, kind of a better testing ground for the deck. Huh, so I mean, Hardened Scales into Walker on 2 is pretty nice, but I don't think we can keep a hand with this many lands. Might end up regretting this if we're against a Thoughtseize deck, but okay, this is a lot better. Just trying to think what we want to put back here. I think I kind of want to keep all three lands here, but I also, you know, everything's pretty sick. I definitely want the Scales. I definitely want to try the Yotian Dissident out, even though I think Smith might be a better card in this particular hand. Portable Hole also seems pretty sick. I mean, maybe we are supposed to put a land back here. Especially on the draw. Yeah, I'm going to try that. Because we can cast everything in our hand already. Okay, so Raugrin Trio makes me think we're probably against a control deck, so maybe we're going to get punished for not keeping a third land here. Hopefully not, though. So we'll lead on the Hardened Scales, obviously, while they're tapped out, kind of. And her. I mean, this is the sort of hand that shows why you can't run too many non-artifacts in the deck. So I'm going to play out the Smith here. I think the pick is probably Esper Sentinel, but yeah, I already regret. I mean, we didn't draw a land, so obviously that factors into my decision, but I do kind of regret not putting the Portable Hole back now. But again, had we been against, like, Wizards, then I would have regretted doing that instead, so So we'll see what the opponent does here. Okay, we did draw our third land, which is huge. So, what do we want to play? I think I'm just going to run out the Ingenious. I think we probably need to play the land first just to play around, like, Sensor or Drawry Disruption. Although, hold on, let me think, because if they have a Sweeper next turn, going Smith into Sentinel kind of makes us run out of gas, so I think I might go Yotian Dissident here. Although, I think I'm just going to run out the land first and then go Yotian Dissident into SB Sentinel. Because we could have gone for the Smith there, but if we brick on the Smith trigger, we don't really have much else to go on after that, so... Now, they could very well have a counterspell here, which would stop the counters on both things. Sick, so it resolves. I mean, I'm kind of surprised about that because, you know, we get blown out by any counterspell there, really. Okay, so they got Prismari Command to kill both of our creatures, which is a bit rough, but at least we do get to draw a card out of it. So yeah, I mean, immediately being able to put counters on the Esper Sentinel with the Dissident did feel pretty nice there. Okay, so they got Teferi who slows the Sunset, which should give us a pretty free turn next turn, but I'm still very concerned about a Sweeper here. This is the sort of spot where I would really like to have the Ozolith. So maybe that's a card that we could look at going up numbers of. Portable Hole or Darksteel Citadel. I mean, Portable Hole isn't going to have that many targets here, so I think it's kind of more important to keep hitting lands, but... So I think I'm just going to put the counters on the Dissident here. And then this should allow us to kill the Teferi. It doesn't look like the opponent has any interaction here. I mean, the other issue with the Ozolith is if the opponent has Divine Purge, which I think should probably be the most commonly played Sweeper. Okay, opponent had Supreme Verdict. So, yeah, maybe we should look at playing Ozolith in higher numbers. Because we don't seem to have very good counterplay against Sweepers so far. So maybe instead of the third animation module, we should look to play the second Ozolith, maybe? Because I definitely did feel like Control was the roughest matchup when I was testing Hardened Scales in the past. And while Guardian of Faith should definitely help, well, I mean, obviously it'll be useful to play the post-sideboard game here, but yeah, we'll have to see. Okay, I mean, animation module... with Yotian Dissident on its own seems pretty good. Oh, I guess I should have played the land before because we basically just get as many activations of this as we have lands in play, so... Yeah, I should have definitely played the planes beforehand. I mean, this is a pretty nice interaction, especially with Hardened Scales. If the opponent doesn't have a Sweeper, they might be in trouble here. But considering they haven't really committed anything to the board, I have to imagine they will have another Sweeper. And I guess the other issue with running high numbers of Ashnod's Altar and Animation Module is you don't really have good ways to loot it away. You know, at least in the red decks where you have like Fable of the Mirror Breaker and Faithless Looting or Seasoned Pyromancer, you can loot away any excess copies you draw, whereas if you draw like, you know, two or three Ashnod's Altars, that's not really that great. Okay, so opponent plays the Shark Typhoon. I assume they block here. Yeah, I mean... That was a complete punt, me not playing the planes there, because we could have made this a... I guess we probably would have still kept putting creatures on the... putting counters on the tokens to play around single target removal a little bit more. But yeah, this interaction seems sick, so maybe I could see just going up more animation modules. Maybe we should be running more, like, higher numbers of the combo piece, or the combo pieces in general. So we have 15 damage here. I think we're probably... Hold on, I need to remember what the secondary ability on this does. Okay. So we can boost the number of counters on stuff with the animation module. But I think we're probably just safer to attack Teferi with everything here. Now, they could have settled the wreckage, but Actually, let me think about this. So, reasonably, what could they have? If they have three removal spells, then... that's super unlikely. I think we can go like this. If they have Settle the Wreckage, we kind of get blown out, but... You know, you can't really constantly play around that card. Maybe we should have buffed one of the 3/3s with the module's secondary ability before it did damage, but... At least it, you know, represents us having more stuff here. Okay, so they go for Narset. Yeah, you can tell I haven't played with Animation Module in a while. I have to keep rereading what the abilities do on this. Hopefully they don't hit a sweeper here. Probably game over if they do, unless we get very lucky draws off the top. But yeah, I mean, I'm not really sure what the best answer is against control, because in previous builds, I was running counter spells. I think Guardian of Faith should definitely help post sideboard, but we don't really have great ways to recover. So maybe focusing more on the combo should be our priority. Okay, so they Helix one of the tokens. That's not the end of the world, really. Oh, wow. Okay, Hangerback Walker is a great draw. So... Let me think here. I think we're going to lead on attacking here. I don't think the opponent's going to reasonably have more than two removal spells, so I think we can go two at Narset, two face. We might get punished by this if they have, like, exactly Helix into March, but they would need to have exactly Valakut Awakening Helix March to get punished for that, so... And I think I'm just going to slam the Hangerback Walker here. How much have we got? 2, 4, 6. See. I mean... I don't want to get punished by a sensor here when we don't really need to, so I think I'm just going to go for X equals 3 and then pay for the animation module as well, because having this just hit by a Jawari when we don't really need to play into it seems like a mistake. And then I think we're just passing here. Now, if they have another Supreme Verdict, we still get the counters off the Hangerback Walker. The cards that we're obviously worried about here are Farewell and Divine Purge, so... If the opponent has either of those, I think we just lose. And to be honest, maybe we should have started attacking face when they had Teferi earlier, but I don't think it meaningfully increases our clock, really, with what we have on board here. So opponent uses Iteration, obviously digging for Divine Purge. I mean, they did play Verdict, so there's a chance they're not even main decking the Purge, but I like to assume that people are going to be main decking Purge because the artifact decks are still going to be about, and I think, you know, you have to be prepared for it, so I would quite like for the opponent to be running Purge just to see how well the deck fares against it, especially Guardian of Faith post sideboard, because in my head that feels like a good answer to Divine Purge, but oftentimes it doesn't actually play out as well as I think it will, if that makes sense. So opponent's still in the tank here about that iteration. I think if they don't have a sweeper here, you know, even if they have like a Wandering Emperor, we probably have enough to win here, I think. I mean, they can exile the Hangerback Walker, puts them up to 15. Oh, wow, they have a four mana Narset, interesting. But, I mean, if they tap out for that, they've only got two mana spare, and I don't think there's anything they can cast for two mana. I guess they do get an extra mana off this and two life. Many paths lie before me. Oh, wow, they can steal a Hangerback Walker. I mean, we have the portable hole for it, but... Yeah, I didn't consider that interaction. Okay, that seems like a pretty sick draw. Because now we can portable hole the Hangerback Walker. And then just put a bunch of counters and stuff. Okay, sick. So this interaction is a lot stronger than I thought it would be. Even without the Ashnod's Altar, that's pretty sick. So I'm, you know... Could we maybe go up to four animation module, potentially? I mean, it does make me a little bit more excited for the Kyla's Reconstruction version of the deck, because the more I play with it, the more I think you could maybe get away with four module, maybe three or four altar. And if you fill the rest of the deck with cheap creatures that you can sacrifice to altar, then Kyla's Reconstruction becomes pretty sick. I don't think Shadowspear is going to be that important. I think Pithing Needle being able to shut off Teferi is pretty nice as well. And yeah, we'll just run it back. I'm very excited to see how this fares against control post sideboard. But yeah, the more I play with Yotian and animation module anyway, the more I think that you could probably just max out four of each of both of those. Okay, so this hand is pretty nice, I think. You know, we can go Mousesaur as the Baz on turn one, Smith or Dissident on turn two, and then we've got, you know, Walker for later in the game as well. So I think I'm going to lead on... Interesting. I mean, I'm going to go for the Mouser. I don't think it really makes much of a difference here. And then probably want to go for Ingenious Smith next turn. And yeah, to be honest, I'm like, now I've played more with Yotian Dissident plus animation module, I do think 22 lands is right. You do want a relatively high land count for to be able to, you know, because even without Ashnod's ulti, you can just fill your board with 1/1s and get a bunch of counters on stuff. Okay, so the opponent's stifle, so they're obviously on, like, we saw Lotus Field last game anyway, but yeah, maybe, I mean, with the Kyla's Reconstruction where you need more mana, I could maybe even see going up to 23, but I'm not really sure what you cut to make room for that sort of stuff, really. So we'll play Hardened Scales here. Then we can play the Darksteel Citadel, which turns Ingenious Smith into a 3-3. And then, I mean, we could play the Hangerback Walker before attacking. I mean, they could have Shark Typhoon for one, which punishes us for not playing this pre-combat. So I'm going to play the Hangerback Walker now, just in case they have Shark Typhoon, because they could go Shark Typhoon, make a shark, block the Mouser, and then we don't get any benefit off the modular. So just going to attack him with the Smith and the Mouser here. If they do have the Shark Typhoon, we can just move the counters from the Mouser onto the Hangerback Walker, which is actually sick because it'll double up the counters and then we'll get more Thopters when it dies. I mean, again, we're obviously very scared of Divine Purge here, but... Okay, so Helix the Smith, that's fine. And then we'll just run it, pass the turn back to the opponent here. But yeah, Yotian Dissident in, you know, I've obviously not played it very much so far, but it does seem pretty powerful just when you're playing it fairly. So yeah, maybe one of the changes I'd be interested in making is try and make it, you know, run slightly more of the combo pieces. The other issue with the Kyla's Reconstruction, okay, they steal the Walker, which kind of sucks. Okay, we got the Guardian of Faith. That's interesting. I think I like going Yotian Dissident and Zabaz here, which then enables us to turn the Arcbound Mouser into a 3-3, which allows us to attack past the Walker here. They could obviously block and get two Thopters, but either way, I'm pretty happy. I mean, that might signal that they have a Supreme Verdict, because they kind of want to keep the Hangerback Walker around. You know, if they wait till they Supreme Verdict, they get the Thopters after the board is cleared, which is obviously be pretty good for them. They can also start putting counters on it manually, but they have to tap it in order to do so, so not sure how interested they'll be in doing that. Next turn will be quite interesting. If they do just pass it back, I think we're probably interested in, you know, holding up Guardian of Faith, because this doesn't just protect from sweepers, it can protect from single target removal as well, which is pretty nice. Although, having said that, getting another hanger back in play would be nice, especially if we draw another land. Okay, so play Teferi here.
I'm not going to sit this one out.
Which I'm pretty confident that we should be able to kill, I think. Maybe not, though, because we don't have two artifacts to play. If we had two artifacts, well, I guess we can try and give Zabaz flying. Oh, wow, they tuck the Zabaz. Okay. Interesting. So, I mean, I think we just have to attack the Teferi down here, but I'm going to go Ingenious Smith first. Oh, we don't have Portable Hole in the deck anymore, which is a bit of an issue, but we can get the Zabaz back. Put the counter on the Dissident, which then means that we can just attack Teferi with both. The slight issue here is that if they do have Supreme Verdict, we kind of get blown out. You know, we're obviously not holding up Guardian of Faith, but I think killing Teferi there is the absolute priority. And yeah, Supreme Verdict is going to be a blowout, because they could tap this, put a counter on it, Supreme Verdict, and then get three Thopters, which would be pretty hard for us to come back from if they have anything else good in their hand. Okay, so they have the Lotus Field. Well, nothing to do with the mana. Okay. I mean, at this point, I think I'm just holding up the Guardian of Faith. Now, they can put a +1/+1 counter on this at instant speed. So I don't want to attack with the Zabat. Actually, no, I don't really mind because it has modular. We can just pass the counters onto the Mouser if they do block the Zabaz. So, like I said, they can block and activate the Hangerback Walker in response. So they might just block the Zabaz here, do that, but then we can just pile the counters onto the Arcbound Mouser. And I just really want to hold up the Guardian of Faith. Okay, interesting. So they block the Mouser. So they will get the Thopped tokens, which is going to be harder for us to attack past. But we've got a 7/7 Zabaz now, which is pretty nice. Although they do have chump blockers in play already. So them stealing Walker is pretty nice, to be honest. Especially if they have like another Teferi, for example. Okay, opponent just passes. So I think... Okay, I want to hold up the Guardian of Faith again here, so I'm going to play out the Mouser, which then enables us to put counters on the Dissident and the Smith to mean that they can't just triple block here. And we can attack him with all three. And again, hope they don't have Cecil the Wreckage, but, you know, I don't think we're in a position to be playing around that card, really. Okay, so the opponent just, you know, triple chump blocks, which we're happy to see. Kind of signifies they're going to be digging for a sweeper now, and we already have the Guardian of Faith as a way to protect against that, so... Okay, so hopefully they don't have a counter spell for this. Okay, sweet, we got there. So, I mean, Guardian of Faith felt pretty good there, to be honest, but that was... You know, I think it's going to be harder to work that well against Divine Purge, maybe, so I would quite like to face control with Divine Purge and see if it's as effective there. Okay, sweet. So we ended up going 4-1 in the first event, which is pretty decent for a first draft. We managed to beat Goblins, Blue-White Control, Mono-Red Aggro, and Dinosaurs, which was kind of like a free win there, really. And then we did lose to a Azorius Blink deck, and I think part of that was just that we weren't able to get aggressive enough. So just trying to think what we learned from that first one. I mean, first of all, I completely forgot about Spire of Industry. So if we go back to the deck here, while it loads, I definitely think we want... Spire of Industry if we're running Zabaz. You know, we don't need the Evergrown Farmland. Honestly, the Darksteel Citadels are more of a liability than anything else against stuff like March of Otherworldly Light, so I think Spire seems pretty good if we continue to run Zabaz. But my main takeaway from this was that, honestly, the combo pieces were a lot less clunky than I thought, and there's a lot of really nice synergy going on between a lot of the combo pieces as well. So I had multiple games where we had, like, just Yotian Dissident plus animation module together basically just allows you to produce tokens and counters for each mana you have, which as a fair game plan is pretty decent. Ashnod's Altar and Hangerback Walker were really, really nice together. Hangerback Walker and Yotian Dissident with Ashnod's Altar was also sick because you can keep pumping a load of counters onto the Hangerback Walker, then sack the Walker to the Ashnod's Altar, and then you get a bunch of Thopters in play, and each of those Thopters entering play triggers the Yotian Dissident. So I think going forwards, I would quite like to run a build with 4 Animation Module, 3 Ashnod's Altar, and because we're going up on Ashnod's Altar, I also like going up Ozolith, and Shadowspear is also another card that I'm pretty high on in general, because if you do set up Yotian Dissident, Ashnod's Altar, Hangerback Walker, you can then, you know, make the Hangerback Walker really big, sack it to Ashnod's Altar to produce 2 mana. You get a bunch of Thopters, which then triggers Yotian Dissident a bunch of times. You can just put a bunch of the counters on Yotian Dissident, and then the 2 mana off Ashnod's Altar allows you to equip the Shadow Spear, which seems pretty nice. The issue is finding space for everything. So, I mean, what was good? Hangerback Walker was great. Ashnod's Altar and Animation Module I want to go up on. I think Ingenious Smith is important in the deck. I think Esper Sentinel is very important for control. Even though we did win the control matchup, it did feel a bit sketchy. It didn't feel like the games were always going to play out like that. And I think Esper Sentinel in a shell with Yotian Dissident is pretty good as well, especially if we're going up on Ozolith slightly. So I think the main cards I'm looking to cut here are Arcbound Mouser and Zabaz, or trim on them anyway. The issue with Zabaz is that it's not that great if you're not running that many other modular cards. I think Mouser was obviously very good against aggro, but if we're going up on Shadowspear, I'm not even 100% sure that we need that many mouses. My issue with changing the deck and adding more animation module, basically just adding more non-creatures to the deck, is that you're going to end up with a lot of hands without many creatures, which is potentially an issue. Another card that I definitely want to try is that Kyla's Resurrection card. I feel like as we go up on numbers of combo pieces, the Kyla's Resurrection is going to be a lot more valuable. So I think in this second build, I do want to try for Kyla's Reconstruction. Oh, Kyla's Reconstruction. I always forget the name of it. Which does mean that we will have to make some changes to the mana base to be able to cast Triple White on turn 3. I also do think that we might have to end up cutting Ingenious Smith as well to fit this in, because, or potentially Hardened Scales. You know, I feel like we don't want too many non-artifacts, First of all, we don't want too many non-artifacts because we'll end up in situations where we're not triggering the Yotian Dissident. We don't want to run too many non-artifact, non-creatures because then we'll start whiffing on the Kyla's Reconstruction. So I think I'm going to try the Reconstruction instead of Ingenious Smith here. And then we've also got to make some cuts between the Mouser and the Zabaz. Maybe we go down to 2 Zabaz, 2 Mouser could potentially work. Now, I am a little bit concerned that we won't have enough creatures to sack to the Ashnod's Altar, or we'll have starts where we have Hardened Scales and nothing to really use the scales with. I mean, it seems kind of weird cutting Hardened Scales when we're essentially a Hardened Scales deck, but, I mean, the deck feels like it can play a lot more like a combo deck because there's some really nice interactions with Yotian Dissident and the Ashnod's Altar and the Hangerback Walker. And Hardened Scales obviously, you know, multiplies those combo lines pretty significantly, but I don't know if it's necessary if we're leaning more into the combo. So I think I'm going to try a couple of games with this, or I mean, I might try it without Hardened Scales, honestly. If we're running Kyla's Reconstruction, we don't really want to be running non-creature, non-artifact stuff. And I feel like, you know, Ingenious Smith is a good hit if we're trying to assemble the combo. So, this is tough. Maybe we just cut the Mousers and the Zabaz, honestly. Maybe we just go Ingenious Smith, but then Hardened Scales isn't that good either, really. This is tough. Yeah, honestly, the more we cut, like, the more we move towards focusing on combo synergies, the less good Hardened Scales become. So I think I might try Ingenious Smith, because that does help find the combo pieces as well. And then maybe we just want to run the 2 Mouser, 2 Zabaz. I mean, it seems kind of mad cutting Hardened Scales in a deck with this much +1/+1 counter synergy. Actually, yeah, surely it is. Surely it's a mistake. So let's try it with the Hardened Scales, and we'll see if we run into issues with not having enough +1/+1 counter synergy. Because what have we got? We've got Smith and Dissident, which are both good. We've got Hangerback Walker. But outside of that, we honestly don't have that much +1/+1 counter stuff. And we need to be triggering the animation module, really. So, Yeah, honestly, I think Hardened Scales could be the cut. It seems kind of mad, but maybe that is the way to go. And then let's just double check +1/+1 counters creature stuff. Just to make sure that we're not missing anything. So we kind of want artifact creatures, I think. Lion Sash I've already gone over, I'm not really a big fan of. I think with Shadow Spear we might not need the modular creatures, but the ability to move your +1/+1 counters around is pretty appealing. Patchwork Automaton is only on cast. If it was like Yotian Dissident, where it is whenever an artifact enters the battlefield, I think I would be a lot higher on it. Let's have a look at the curve, though. I mean, to be honest, maybe Patchwork Automaton is better in this particular build now. I would be tempted to run it now because I feel like when you're running the modular creatures, you want to have a high density of them so that Zabaz is good. Now, I think we could get away with Patchwork Automaton, and I think we also want to increase the curve slightly if we're running Kyla's Reconstruction, just to make sure that we're actually getting good value off it. Now, Spire of Industry is a card that I said that I'm not super high on if we're not running Zabaz, but since we need triple white on turn 3, I think Spire is actually pretty decent. But I think instead of the Forest, I'm just going to go up a Plains, and to be honest, I might end up cutting the Besaidu as well, because we only need green on turn 2 now. In terms of the sideboard, I mean, I'm not sure I want to make any changes to the sideboard. We've already got the second Shadow Spear there for matchups where it's good. And I think everything else felt pretty reasonable there. I like Glass Casket with the reconstruction, so I think I'm just going to try a league with this and see how we do. Okay, so we're going first here. And no play on turn one, but I think, you know, if Yotian Dissident survives here, being able to immediately put counters on the Hangerback Walker seems pretty sick to me. But yeah, thinking again, I mean, it is a tough deck building puzzle because what initially drew me to this archetype in general was that I thought that it would work super well with Harden Scales. And I think it does, but the more I play with it, I think the more you lean into the combo, the less hardened scale, the less good hardened scales becomes. Okay, so they thought sees we lose the Dissident, which is a bit of an issue. But, you know, Hangerback Walker against Rakdos should be pretty decent because we can just start ticking it up every single turn. Next turn we can play another Hangerback on one and keep putting counters on it. Which I think is going to be pretty difficult for, if we are, I assume against Rakdos because that's the most common, you know, turn one Thoughtseize deck. Okay, they have another Thoughtseize, so I assume we lose the other Hangerback Walker. Yeah. And it would be a bit annoying if they Fatal Push as well. Oh, wow, okay. So, I'm gonna play the Brushland out here just to conceal information. You know, I don't want to give away that we've just drawn nothing again. I would quite like them to use another discard spell if possible. Well, I wouldn't like them to, but yeah. They might be less likely to use that if they knew we only had Portable Hole, if that makes sense. So unfortunately we are flooding out, but the fact that we have Kyler's Reconstruction in the deck now makes me more optimistic at recovering from behind, because that did feel like an issue with the previous build, that if the opponent was able to stop your initial game plan or they use a sweeper like Divine Purge or something, it's very difficult to come back from that. Whereas now with Kyler's Reconstruction, you actually have a way to rebuild. Wow, the Meat Hook for X equals 2, sure. Wow, okay. Speaking of, I think we just have to go for this right now. Just because they could have Thoughtseize. Wow, okay. So I think we definitely want to go for Ingenious Smith and probably Patchwork Automaton. You know, Esper Sentinel's kind of appealing, but it's getting to the point in the game where it's not really going to be that impactful, I don't think. Oh, okay, interesting. I think we just go for the Hangerback Walker here, and if they don't have another discard spell, we can just slam that for, you know, X equals 3. I mean, that Kyler's Reconstruction felt really nice. So maybe this is the way to build the deck going forward. Ah, okay, so opponents on Mono Black Devotion, sure. Wow, okay, another Reconstruction. So I think I'm just going to slam that. And I think we do it for 3. Let's see what we hit here. Huh. Oh, we get to put them all into play. Right, sick. So I think we want to buff one on the Ingenious Smith, one on the Esper Sentinel, and now we can start attacking with the Ingenious Smith here. Now, the Automaton not being on when they enter the battlefield and then just being on the cast is a little bit annoying. So maybe there's something better. Like, this is definitely the flex slot in the deck, I feel. Wow, okay. Animation module's sick. Because now we get to loop the Yotian Dissidents. We'll put that up to 4 toughness. And then every single animation module trigger that we get gets us 2 more counters on the Dissidents. So I think we'll buff the Automaton here. Buff the Automaton again, and then I think we'll start buffing one of these Yotian Dissidents. 3, 4. Oh wait, we need to consider Meat Hook Massacre again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, yeah, we should start. Okay, opponent just scoops it up. Okay, that felt sick. That felt a lot better than what we were doing before. Kaida's Reconstruction seems real nice in it here. Now, Patchwork Automaton did feel a little bit meh, but, you know, there are other options that we can run, and I think it's only going to feel meh if we do it off Reconstruction. Okay, so against Rakdos... Oh, again, no, we're not against Rakdos, are we? We're against Mono Black Devotion, so... Honestly, I'm not really sure what we want here. I don't think Casket's going to be any better than Portable Hole. Karn, you know, is only good for Artifact Hate. We don't really have anything good to pick off it. Maybe we just run it back, honestly. I'm just going to run it back and see how it does. But yeah, that felt, in general, like, obviously we did draw two of the Kaida's Reconstructions, but in general, that felt a lot better. I think having access to a way to recover from behind helps a lot. You know, one of the things that I was noticing the most when I was playing the older version of the deck was that if the opponent had a sweeper or they managed to kill a lot of our stuff, it was super hard to come back from behind. Whereas now, you know, with Yotian Dissident, there's a lot of cool synergies within the deck. Okay, so apparently he's on Inquisition. I assume they take the Ingenious Smith here. Wow, they take the Automaton. Interesting. Yeah, after this I might have a quick look to see if there are any other cards that work when artifacts enter the battlefield rather than just off casting. So this is an interesting turn. What do we want to go for here? I mean, I kind of like Automaton because it's hard for them to kill. Yeah, I think I'm just going to go for the Automaton here because they can't Fatal Push it if they have that. Whereas Dissident is obviously very vulnerable. Ingenious Smith does replace itself. We are obviously kind of weak to Liliana, though, but it is what it is. Okay, so they Thought Seize us. And to be honest, you know, now we're not casting it off Kaida's Resurrection, this does actually seem pretty good now, the Automaton. Okay, interesting. I think we want to lead on the Ingenious Smith here. And hopefully hit a one mana artifact. Okay, perfect. That's great. So now we can cast the Esper Sentinel. Okay, they push the Smith, but that's fine, I think. Now we can start getting aggressive. Now, this is kind of a situation where, you know, Yotian Dissident doesn't trigger the Automaton. So I'm not sure how well these cards do work together. No reason to not attack in here, I don't think. Now, they could have a sweeper, but I feel like we just want to commit to the board here. You know, I don't think we're really likely to be beating a sweeper anyway if we play slowly. You know, we don't want to give them time to, like, maybe slam a shield red and start gaining a bunch of life or... Yeah, exactly, okay. So we do have Iganjo as a way to kill that. So I think we just attack all. I presume they block here. And then we can just Iganjo the shield red. Oh, wow. They just let it through. Okay, that's kind of concerning. I'm surprised they didn't block there. I guess, you know, if they have ways to draw cards, they feel like they can probably just ride the life gain off shield red to stabilize against us. Huh, interesting. So we get two Dissident triggers here. What do we target? I mean, we could boost the Automaton up to 5/5. I don't mind doing that, to be honest. And then they could Fatal Push, but they have to pay the ward tax then. If they wait for us to attack to Fatal Push, we can just sack the Automaton in response. Okay, they fire up the Hive. That's fine. Okay. I mean, we definitely want to kill the Shieldred here. And the Yotian Dissident's dying anyway. They can't kill the automaton post-combat, so I think we can just kill the hive here. Maybe that was a waste. Maybe we could have just held on to the Yaganjo, but at least that shuts off their creature land. Now we're kind of in an awkward position, though, because we don't have that much on board, and they do have three cards in hand. Oh, wow, they have a second shield red. Yikes. Yeah, so maybe I should have held on to that Yaganjo. Okay, Shadow Spear. And I think we'll equip the Esper Sentinel just to get maximum value off the tax. Yeah, I do feel like I played this game kind of loose. Maybe I was a bit too aggressive with that Yaganjo last turn. But I feel like we just have to apply pressure here. Okay, they don't attack, which is obviously good to see. Wow, another land, not ideal. So I'm just going to pass, bluffing something here. I assume they can start activating the castle because they're gaining life off the Shieldred as well. Yeah, so they're only losing one life to draw a card there, which is, you know, pretty good rate off a land. So go back up to 7. I mean, we'd love to see, like, Kyla's Reconstruction. Honestly, I think that card is such a good upgrade to the deck. The fact that we just have the option to potentially just win the game off a top deck is really, really nice. Okay, they Thought Seize. Okay, they give us the draw and we draw a land, so got maximum value off that exchange. But now the opponent knows that we just have nothing. To be honest, maybe we're supposed to just keep playing our lands out. Actually, I don't know. The only way this is going to matter is if we draw Kyla's Reconstruction and can't put an extra card into play. Oh, okay. Animation module is sick here, right? Wait, is that lethal? Because we can keep putting the counters on the Esper Sentinel, right? Unless they have a removal spell. Okay, they do have a removal spell. Oh wait, we just have the combo. I'm an idiot. I completely missed that we just have the combo here, so we should just win, right? And we have the Shadow Spear as well. So maybe Shadow Spear is more important than... what am I saying? Maybe Shadow Spear is more important than Ozolith because of spots like this where you can just give your creature infinite power and trample. Okay, sweet. Okay, that felt so much better. I think this version of the deck is a lot better, to be honest. Okay, so what did we learn from playing? Well, I think this build of the deck definitely felt a lot better. One change I've made since the event is I've gone up to the second Shadow Spear and down one Ozolith because Shadow Spear is really nice with the combo. If you have the combo, you can then just win the turn you're comboing off, assuming you have a creature that can attack, because you can just pump all of the Yotian Dissident +1/+1 counters onto the creature without summoning sickness. Then with the final 2 mana you get off the Ashnod's Altar, you can just equip the Shadow Spear and attack in for lethal. So Shadow Spear feels really good to enable you to win the turn you're comboing off, which is nice. And it also works very nicely with cards like Patchwork Automaton and Genius Smith as well as like the Hangerback Walker as well. In general, I think this build is much better because there's a lot of... obviously, you have access to a combo, which is sick. We can assemble it a lot better because we have so many you know, we have a lot more copies of it than the original deck. Kaida's Reconstruction also felt like such a big upgrade. I felt like one of the biggest issues with the old build was that if you get, you know, if the opponent sweeps the board with like a Divine Purge or they're able to deal with all of your early threats, it's so hard to come back from behind. Whereas having Kaida's Reconstruction as a card that can just not only completely refuel you, but potentially win the game on the spot from an empty board if you get a good hit off it as well. So I'm really, really high on this card in the shell in general. Obviously, the, you know, the weird card to not be running anymore is Hardened Scales, but I'm not sure what you would cut to make room for it. Oh, hold on, can't spell. Because I feel like this deck, or this particular build of the deck, is much more focused around synergy and combo. You know, Yotian Dissident plus Animation Module just completely fills your board and gets a bunch of plus one counters on it, which is really good if you're just playing like a fair game plan. Ashnod's also Hangerback Walker is really good. You know, sacking Hangerback Walker with a Dissident in play and getting a bunch of plus one counters when the Thopters enter play is really sick. And Hardened Scales feels win more in this shell, if that makes sense. Like, if there was room for it, you know, if control wasn't a big deal, you could maybe run it in place of Esper Sentinel. You know, if we didn't need removal, you could maybe run it in place of Portable Hole. But I feel like, you know, if you run Hardened Scales, it's a whiff off Kaida's Reconstruction. You're going to end up with hands with Hardened Scales, Yotian Dissident, and nothing to, you know, nothing to trigger the plus one counters. Because if you look at the deck, we don't have that much plus one counter stuff. We've got Smith, Dissident, Automaton, and Hangerback Walker. And we don't, these are all pretty key cards in the deck, I think. You know, if you cut any of these for Hardened Scales, you only have like 12 creatures that plus one counters on stuff. And I'm not sure what you would cut to fit in the scales. Like I said, Sentinel's super important against control. And just non-creature stuff in general. I feel like Sentinel's one of the best cards in the format. And since we can put counters on it with Dissident and Ozolith, it's probably one of the better Sentinel decks in the format as well. Portable Hole is absolutely necessary for sure. And then the rest of the deck, you know, I just don't think there's room for it anymore, to be honest. Now, having said that, I have only played a few matches with this deck. I'm sure as I play more matches, I'm going to iterate and make more changes to it. One other change that I was tempted to, well, considering anyway, was Skyclave Apparition in the sideboard over Glass Casket, but I'm not really sure that's necessary. Glass Casket being able to be found off Ingenious Smith and triggering Yotian Dissident and Patchwork Automaton is very nice. And Skyclave Apparition is only really better against the artifact decks where we already have Karn as kind of like a way to shut their deck off anyway. So in general, I'm really liking how this particular build feels. I'm going to be working on it going forwards. I'm also going to leave an MTG Zone link in the description for this build of the deck. So if you're interested in, you know, picking the deck up and trying to kind of, you know, work on it a bit more, if you come up with any good innovations or you take the deck in a different direction, absolutely let me know in the comments. I'd love to know where you guys take this deck if you're interested in playing it. I hope you enjoyed this. If this is the sort of video you enjoyed, definitely let me know in the comments and I'll be sure to be doing more. I'm going to continue working on this deck, so if I can get it to a point where it's good, I'll do more of an in-depth deck guide on it with more gameplay as well. Like I said, if you enjoy this series, definitely let me know, because there's a bunch of other ideas I've got that I haven't started building yet, and I found it really fun to do this sort of video. So there's a lot of other decks that I could do in this sort of style, if that makes sense. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video. Let me know in the comments if you've got any questions about the deck, or if you end up innovating on it at all, and I'll catch you all in the next video. Big up.